Getting into space is tough, expensive work. It takes a lot of energy to fire a rocket up and move out of the planet's atmosphere into a zero gravity orbit. As we have talked in the previous episodes of this series, the rocket fuel is the initial 80% demands of a rocket, and how rockets are encumbered by the need to use propellant to accelerate propellant. For example, Saturn V rocket, it took 326,770 gallons of liquid hydrogen and 99,359 gallons of liquid oxygen to get the rocket out of the atmosphere. So this method of propulsion takes a lot of fuel. But the main draw here is not the price of the fuel, but the enormous mass and storage it takes. One way to save on rocket fuel is not to use any. What if instead of running a relatively slow controlled burn all the way up to space, we had one giant boom down here on the ground? Why don't we just fire things into space from a huge cannon? That's the school of thought behind a long hypothesized technology called space guns. It's been claimed by loading a satellite or spacecraft into the barrel of a gun and aiming it upward, we could put objects into space for a fraction of the cost of a satellite. In 1961, the US and Canada jointly created a project called HARP, High Altitude Research Project, with the goal of creating a system of non-rocket low-cost launch system. HARP was basically the culmination of years worth of work by Gerald Bull, a mad scientist and a ballistics engineer who had been pioneering the notion of firing aircraft out of guns. The aim of the project was to create a cartoonishly large gun to shoot things into space from a 16-inch cannon, and the length of the gun is 40 meters long, making it too big for an effective military application, but seemingly perfect for a satellite delivery. This colossal gun was not designed for delivering humans, but instead, the cannon fired smaller projectiles in a sabot that would protect the payload during the firing and would fall away as the satellite rose. So in 1963, under a clear blue sky, the first shot was fired. A 315 kilogram wooden slug was propelled over 3 kilometers in the air, flying for 58 seconds before landing about a 1 kilometer offshore. It was a complete success. So further scheduled test firings were abandoned and preparations were made to fire a real projectiles. The next day, a Martlet 1 was launched. The Martlet was a dart-like finned projectile resembling a small rocket. It flew far higher to an altitude of 26 kilometers with a flight time of 155 seconds. 2 days later, a second Martlet 1 reached 27 kilometers with a radio transmitter beacon attached. This allowed the team to track the projectiles throughout the course of its flight. And the research team figured out that they are using a decade-old gunpowder, so the quality of the gunpowder was very low, making the speed of the projectile inefficient. So the powder was replaced and a world record altitude had been reached of just 92 kilometers for a gun-launched projectile. The Martlet was equipped with electronics that released chemical markers at set altitudes, leaving a smoke trail through the sky that could be used to measure upper-level winds. Some even used additional electronics to measure magnetic fields. In 1966, a Martlet 2 was launched just short of 180 kilometers high, a world record for a gun-launched projectile that remains to this day, and just a half the way to the International Space Station. The Martlet 2 quickly became the workhorse of the program and proved itself by carrying many diverse payloads. It could be launched for a cost of about $3,000 each at intervals of less than an hour. Over the length of the HARP program, some 200 Martlet 2 were launched, making it one of the most successful suborbital vehicles ever developed. Sorry, Jeff. The speed of the projectile was less than the half of that necessary to reach low Earth orbit, so Bull wanted to continue. He designed a more complex Martlet 3 and Martlet 4, which were miniature rockets with their own thrusters. But unfortunately, with the cancellation of sponsorships from both Canadian and US governments, the Project HARP was over. And what if we made a little bigger cannons with today's technology and resources so we could fire a spacecraft with humans inside right up to space without using any propellant? Well, let me give you an example. When you go up in an elevator, you feel as if you are getting squashed. That's a slight acceleration. By comparison, on a roller coaster, you may feel as much as 5 times more acceleration. With jet fighter pilot training, humans can endure about 10 to 20 times the elevator without passing out. Much beyond that would be fatal. It's not the speed that kills you, it's the acceleration, the change in speed. Well, another analogy, when you accelerate in a car, notice how the water in a cup rushes back and stays back until you stop accelerating. Imagine the cup is your body and the water is your blood, and instead of 0 to 100 in 5 seconds, you are going from 0 to 27,200 kilometers per hour when you are fired out of cannon. For delicate and weak payloads like us, humans, explosion-based space cannon is not a great route to space exploration, but specially designed solid payloads like metals, electronics, fuel, water, and plastics can be sent from the gun to the orbiting gigantic space station or could be used to build a hypothetical Dyson sphere around the sun. But this method could potentially be combined with a hybrid system as ramjet and scramjet, as we have discussed in the video about how space planes can effectively take us to space and beyond. I will put on the cards if you want to check it out. Well, thanks for watching. This was the fourth episode of this alternative cheaper spacecraft launch series. I will try to release more videos as fast as possible, but this hardware I'm using right now is slowing me down a bit. Please support the channel on Patreon, it will help to increase the quality of the videos, and subscribe not to miss upcoming episodes.